This month, Deloitte published their top human capital trends report for 2024. And this was based on research that they carried out across 95 countries. And top of that list, trends list, was embracing human sustainability. In other words, creating those regenerative workplace cultures where people actually leave in a better place than when they entered the workplace. And the kind of one of the quote, now this is 122 pages, I think it is, this report, and I have not had a chance to go all the way through it, far from it. But one of the things that they kind of noted with regards to the kind of workplace cultures at the moment, as it says on screen there, generally organisations are stuck in a mindset of extracting value from people rather than working with them to create a better future for the organisations and individuals alike. According to the World Health Organization, the most common obstacle to workplace well-being and self-care is that leaders don't promote well-being. So a question for you now, why do you think that might be? Why do you think that might have been found to be the case, that leaders don't promote well-being? Cost? Lack of time. Yeah, time. It does take time initially. Up front, it takes time, but that time pays off. With the organisations, PayPal, using that as the example, and they're not the only one, then once they've invested up front that time and developed a more regenerative culture, the positive impact that it actually has then upon productivity, engagement, retention, is enormous. So actually, yes, it's cost heavy, time-wise, up front, but over the long term, it pays off. The second reason is that through the neuroscience lens, we know that power alters perspectives. Leaders, because of the very nature of their roles, they spend a lot more time focusing on strategies, goals, results, very kind of what I'm going to call task focused, as opposed to people focused. And they tend to prioritize these things above themselves and even above their families. Therefore, their neural circuitry used for focusing on the task will be much stronger, much more easily accessible than their people-focused networks, which are used when thinking about either themselves or other people. Now, we know that the brain will always go to the pathway of least resistance, so it naturally goes towards the neural circuitry that focuses on strategies, goals, the task-orientated circuitry, as opposed to the people-orientated circuitry. And I remember going to a conference many years ago now, and hearing David Jones, who was the CEO of Next, speak. And he was explaining about his life as CEO of Next, etc. And he spoke about he had been diagnosed with Parkinson's disease at a very, very early age. And he said about how he sat there in the consultant's office, being given his diagnosis after all the results. And he said, as soon as the consultant said that he had got Parkinson's disease, the very first thought that went through his brain was not, what about my family? What about me? It was, what about the share price? What effect is it going to have on the share price? I cannot let this get out. And for several years, as long as he possibly could, there was only two people in his life that knew that he had Parkinson's disease. One was his wife and the other was PA, because he was so concerned about the effect that that information get out into the market would have on the share price. And that's a typical example of that leaders and the circuitry and the people focus is secondary to that task focus. And that again is one of the other reasons that gets in the way. Yes, there is the cost. Yes, there is the kind of the time implications. And I'm not kind of putting those down, but there is also this much more deep-rooted biological reason as to why.